The Simple Truth, rising up to explore the difficult topics of real life. Join us as we proclaim the good, the true, and the beautiful with the simple truth of Jesus Christ and His Holy Catholic Church through Scripture, tradition, and the Catechism. And now, your host, Jim Hayes.
It is great to be back with you on The Simple Truth. We consecrate everything to the Sacred Heart of Jesus through the Immaculate Heart of Mary and the pure, strong heart of Saint Joseph. Today is Testimony Tuesday, where we bring you real, live, firsthand testimonial accounts of the life-giving reality of Jesus and His Catholic Church. Our guest today is Elizabeth Gillette. She is a Catholic wife, mother, pro-life advocate, writer, and speaker, author of the book Above All Love, Discerning Ways to Defend Life with Charity and Justice. It's due out this October through OSV. ElizabethGilletteAuthor.com is where you can learn more. Elizabeth Gillette, thank you so much for being with us today. How are you?
I'm great. Thank you for having me. This is a wonderful opportunity. Thank you.
Absolutely. Yeah. Great blessing to have you with us. And we always begin at the beginning. So let's start with childhood. What was your early life like, your family, the culture that you grew up in?
I was very lucky. I had a wonderful, I call it a golden childhood. I grew up with three brothers, all older than me. My dad is a Protestant and my mom is a Catholic. So I had a really beautiful mosaic of experiences. I went to Protestant summer camps as a lifeguard, and I received my baptism as an infant in the Catholic Church. But we tended to put activities above church activities, like sports and things like that. So while I had a relationship with Jesus Christ and I read my Bible, I wasn't really practicing any kind of faith outside of personal prayer. And I like to say my childhood ended my eighth grade year. I had a really unfortunate experience with a teacher who was sexually molesting some of my classmates, and I was the whistleblower for that. And that marked really the end of innocence for me, and it was the beginning of realizing that the world is bigger than the safe shelter that my parents had created for me. And I did go into some difficult times there. You know, your adolescence is very difficult. I ended up having to move schools, and it wasn't until my senior year that I started to receive dreams of the chalice. I remember the first dream I had, it just was floating in front of me, and it was so beautiful. And I remember asking my mom, like, what is this? What does this mean? And she goes, you're going to go to RCIA immediately. So she was my sponsor my senior year. I went through RCIA. I received all of the rest of my sacraments and became a full-fledged Catholic, which was a wonderful journey and a wonderful experience. But then, you know, it's one thing to receive all your sacraments. It's very much another to walk that path continuously. And as a young woman in today's society, I was not able to stay on the path 100% of the time. There were things that I didn't want to give up. There were things I wasn't ready to yield. And so that transformation took years, a really long time. And I think we all continue that transformation until death. But those were some very difficult growing pains in college and beyond.
Mm-hmm. Wow. Yeah, incredible. So I guess first question that comes to mind is the school that you were going to when the abuse took place. You were the whistleblower. What a difficult situation. Was that a public school? Was that a Christian school? What kind of school was that?
Yeah, it was a public middle school in a small town here in Oregon. And I think the most tragic thing about it is that I wasn't the first whistleblower. I was the last whistleblower because I blew really loud, because I have always had a sense of justice, and that has driven me forward in my life. But as an adult, I have found other victims and I have found other whistleblowers who did say what was going on, and the public school covered it up. So, you know, we live in a different time today than we did in the late 90s, early 2000s. But it was a tragedy that nobody took care of the kids. They protected the teacher.
Wow. Yeah. So horrible. And, so yeah, I mean, we've got evil, we've got sin in the world, very serious, evils that take place. And so, an eighth grader to be coming into contact with that world, very, very sad, certainly would shatter innocence and just be, a very horrible thing. At the same time though, then, what you shared about then your high school years, your senior year in particular, this vision of the chalice, this vision of great beauty, of our Lord Jesus, our Eucharistic Lord Jesus, coming clear in this amazing way, really the exact opposite, where instead of abuse, he's offering you love for your own sake because you are lovable. Was there anything that took place in that, in you entering the Catholic Church, receiving the sacraments, that would have been rounding out, I guess, a picture of evil and grace to help you, I guess, with the way to really understand the world, your identity, and how to navigate it?
Well, I was so young when this initially took place. 14, you're a child. And what I experienced was just severe anger. I was very angry at the people who did not protect us. I was angry that people didn't listen. They didn't believe. They blamed me. They called me a liar. You know, it was just a lot of anger, which I then poured into sports, swimming in particular. But the beginning of Christ coming into my life via the Catholic Church was the beginning of a soul transformation on a level so subtle and so gentle, that it took years, probably 15 years, before any of it was even remotely considered completed. And what Christ did for me was he took that anger and he siphoned it through his body and taught me what compassion truly is. So to this day, it's really difficult for me to get angry at anyone, you know, in a way that is, you know, evil. I find it easier to look at someone who's hurting me or hurting others and think, wow, you are a person that deserves dignity. And I can see that dignity thanks to the gift that Christ has given me.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, amazing. Yeah, Elizabeth Gillette is with us, ElizabethGilletteAuthor.com. Elizabeth, as you were getting then towards the end of your senior year, where was your head at in terms of discerning the future, college, what you were called to? What can you share with us about the transition from senior year onward?
Yeah, I did go to college. I wanted to be a teacher, and I went to a wonderful school, and I was on the right path, so to speak. But I was doing also what most young women and men do. I had a boyfriend and I was sexually active, and I could not give that up. I could not sacrifice that part of my life, even though I knew that that's what God wanted me to do. And I fought it every single day, and I ended up losing that battle every single day. But I did find great beauty in going to Mass. I received the spiritual gift of tears. I still to this day receive it during the Eucharist, most every Sunday. And it was really God saying, I know you want to go that way, but please come this way. I want to pull you over here. I have work for you to do. And I said yes to this relationship with him, but it was conditional. It was like, yeah, I love you, Jesus. I love everything that you've done for me, but I also love this part of my life and I'm not ready to give this up yet. So I didn't. And that ultimately is what got me into some really difficult places in my young adult life where I ended up pregnant.
Mm-hmm. Yes. Yeah. Yeah. I mean, there's a, There's a reason that the church teaches what it does about sexual integrity. When you're a young person, and maybe, you know, we don't fully understand how the teaching authority of the church works for our good, right? It can be a difficult, proposition to say, okay, well, I don't think I want to give this aspect of my life up, when really it's a great gift if we could only embrace it as it truly is. What else can you share, I guess, about that time? We're about to head into the break, but just real quick, anything regarding just your sense of that this was church teaching, and that was that a sense of kind of like a burden, like something that was negative to you, or did you understand church teaching as being a real blessing and gift?
Yeah, I definitely knew that church teaching was a blessing. It was a gift. It was right. And I wanted desperately to follow it. I just didn't have the strength or the courage to do so.
Well, all right. Elizabeth Gillette is with us. We're going to have a lot more as we go here. Again, she is a pro-life advocate, writer, and speaker, ElizabethGilletteAuthor.com. And maybe you can relate. Maybe this is a show in particular to share with some young people that maybe are in your midst that you know can relate already to what has been shared here. And the fact is that, we want to go to our Lord. We want to ask Him for that grace. We need His grace. We are in desperate need of His grace, of His strengthening, of His help, of His healing, of everything in our thoughts, in our actions, in our words. And when we start to forget that, we get into some trouble, like Peter, who said, yeah, I'm going to be right there. I'll give my life with you, Lord. We need to ask for His grace. We're going to be right back. Stay tuned.
Hi, Joe McLean here, host of A Catholic Take, heard on the Station of the Cross each weekday morning at 7 a.m. Eastern. A bold synthesis of information and inspiration, keeping you up to date on the news and issues that you may have missed from a courageous Catholic perspective. That's A Catholic Take, weekday morning, 7 a.m., right here on the Station of the Cross and the free iCatholic Radio mobile app. Download it today. God love you.
The Station of the Cross is listener-funded, and we value your ongoing generosity. In this fast-paced world, it's easy to let your recurring donation slip due to something like a new address or a card number change. If you suspect that we might not have your up-to-date donor information, you can check with us during regular business hours at 1-877-888-6279, extension 104, or anytime online at thestationofthecross.com.
The Catholic Current, bringing Christ to the world and the world to Christ.
The genius of the Middle Ages was to see all things as a whole and integrated. Now everything is specialized. And I love this one quote. It says, we're learning more and more about less and less.
Until eventually we know everything about nothing.
The Catholic Current, 5 p.m. Eastern, from the Station of the Cross and on the iCatholic Radio mobile app.
Our bumper magnets are a great way to promote the gospel as proclaimed through Catholic radio. We hear all the time from new listeners who were introduced to the station through a bumper magnet. We'd be happy to send you a bumper magnet so that others can come to know our Lord. Just go to thestationofthecross.com and find our bumper magnet request button under the About tab. That's thestationofthecross.com under the About tab.
Simple Truth. Jim Havens here. Testimony Tuesday with our guest today, Elizabeth Gillette. She is a Catholic pro-life advocate, writer, speaker, author of the book Above All Love, Discerning Ways to Defend Life with Charity and Justice. It's due out this October through Our Sunday Visitor, ElizabethGilletteAuthor.com. So Elizabeth, we left off then in the college years. You knew it was wrong, but still, sexually active at this time, wanted to break away from all that, but just too strong of a pull, didn't have the strength. And then a pregnancy results, certainly want to continue to move forward on that. But quick question, While we're still at this point, and thank you for your testimony so far and being vulnerable going to this spot, because I think this is a spot that doesn't get talked about much. And there's a lot of people struggling in this spot as they're listening to us today. And that is in habitual, consistent, mortal sin. They don't want to be there. I remember being in that situation as a young person for a time. And for me, it was just relying upon going back to confession, going back to receiving the Eucharist in a state of grace, falling again, getting back to confession and being tormented before the priest saying, I know when I leave here, I'm going to do this again and I don't want to. And he simply said to me, well, then you come back. And so that's what I did. I relied on what I knew, confession, Eucharist in a state of grace, and eventually the freedom began to come, thanks be to God. But for you, is there anything you can share about that time? Were you going to confession during that time? Was there a power in confession that you experienced at all?
I think that you and I differ here because I did not go to confession. I was terrified of confession. In fact, the first time I ever went to confession was my senior year of high school through RCIA. So it was not something that I practiced. It was very scary to admit to another human being, hey, I am doing something that I know I should not be doing. And I also think it's important to point out that I was raised by a father and then three older brothers who were very good men. They were a good example. They led me, they protected me. And so when I stepped out on my own and I went to college, I expected to be surrounded by other men like that. But I found very quickly that that was not the case. In fact, I was looked at as something that could be used and abused. And I did not realize that women in particular are seen as, you know, an object. That was new and it shocked me and I didn't know how to get away from that. So I spent my entire college career and then several years after that searching for a man that could lead me. And the only way I could get one was to share the very part of me that God said I should not share. And it didn't work. It didn't work any of the times I tried. It did not work, you know, with just having a boyfriend. I couldn't keep him, or I didn't want to keep him once I realized, you know, that he under the facade of caring actually didn't care. So I was really trying to navigate the world as the world would have us navigate it. And I ignored the truth that Christ was offering me. And that was, Elizabeth, you have value. You don't need to go chase a man to validate you. You don't need to be married. You don't need to have a boyfriend. You have value in yourself just because I made you that way. And it took, I like to call myself a 2x4 person, because it takes God hitting me on the side of the head with a 2x4 before I will come out of it and say, okay, wow, you have something really important that you want to share with me. And ultimately that was a pregnancy. And it wasn't just one. I'm really ashamed to say I had three crisis pregnancies. So, and I know that I'm not alone in admitting that. I know that there are thousands of women who have walked this path, and some of them don't ever take the grace that God is offering them. And I know they're still in that shadow, and I know how that feels. So hopefully, sharing this will be a beacon of light for some of those women.
Mm-hmm. Yes. Yeah. Very powerful testimony here with Elizabeth Gillette, and yeah, a natural, that this is natural consequences of the marital act, sex outside of marriage, taking that act outside of marriage or inside of marriage, right? The marital act, it's meant to, certainly a child can be conceived and that ought to be received as a blessing. If it's within marriage, then very naturally so. It is received as a blessing most always, but the way that the culture has gone in our time, the time that we have been born into, sadly, now for many women, it's, yeah, I'm going to control this aspect of life. I'm going to be able to do these things and control it all. And I could use contraception. And we know that that oftentimes is what leads then to these crisis pregnancies, because people are taking contraception thinking like they're in control. And then it's not 100%, or, you know, it's very, very tricky at times for it to be very accurate, based on if somebody misses taking their pill one time, then that kind of throws things off. So there's lots of ways that that can go wrong. And then when the pregnancy comes and it was totally unexpected and totally not wanted, thinking you're going to be in control of this, and then here's a child, that's where Planned Parenthood, these abortion centers, are very willing to swoop in, the abortion mindset of the culture, to swoop in. Oh, well, it's just a mistake. Let us fix this for you, or whatever it is. What were the lies that came in, or what was anything that you want to share in your experience of experiencing a pregnancy in this way, in a world that is really filled with lies and deception to really lead you the wrong way?
Yeah, so my first crisis pregnancy did end in the death of my child at the hands of chemical abortion. I'll just say that right now. The other two crisis pregnancies I did carry to term, and I have a beautiful daughter and a son. So there was redemption there. But the first one, my boyfriend, we were both perfectly capable of having a baby. We were in our early 20s. I had a college degree. We were both employed. There was no reason why, you know, according to society, why we should have not had this child. And I think that he really did love me, and I really loved him. And there really was nothing barring this child except shame and fear, because we both came from Catholic homes. Mm-hmm. And he said, you know, I am too young to be a father. I can't do this. I do not want to do this. And I took on this responsibility for his future. I felt like, well, I'm pregnant. I'm going to ruin his future if I don't do something about this. And he was pushing Planned Parenthood, gave me the number, told me to make an appointment. So here's this person that I love, that I expected to treat me like my brother or my father would have and protect me. And that was the opposite of what was happening. And so I ended up calling Planned Parenthood. And from the moment I made contact with them, they started the coercion. And people say that, you know, abortion facilities don't coerce women. In my experience, they very much do. And they do it under the guise of compassion and urgency. So, for example, I called the clinic and I said, I'm really not sure what I want to do. Can I make an appointment? Do you have a fee if I cancel my appointment? And the receptionist said, you know, when women call here, they're already decided. It's our experience that if you're making this call, this is already what you want. There was no referral out to any other option. No other option was even discussed. Then she started to talk about the urgency of the situation. You only have a certain number of weeks before you have to have this horrific surgical invasive procedure. But if you come in right away, we can just give you a pill, and you can have an abortion in the comfort of your own home. So it was breeding fear. It was breeding urgency. I felt like, you know, every day I waited, I was a ticking time bomb that was going to explode. So I made the appointment, and we went in together, and my boyfriend put $800 on the counter. And I just looked at that amount of money and thought, that's so much money. Why are we doing this? Why are we here? Even in the drive over, I remember thinking, maybe the tire will blow, or maybe, you know, as we pass this Mennonite school, somebody will be outside and I can go to them. Maybe, you know, they know Christ, they can help me. And driving up to the facility, I thought, okay, God, if someone's praying on the side of the facility, I'm going to run to them and I'm going to get out of here. I'm not going to go in. unfortunately, no one was praying on the sidewalk that day. And we went in, and the providers, I asked, can I get a refund if I change my mind? And at that point, the receptionist starts to get angry, and she says, look, you're here already. People don't just leave. When they come here, they're already decided, but I guess you can have a refund for part of the procedure you don't receive. So once you go into the room, you're going to pay for it. Once you get an ultrasound, you're going to pay for it. Once the doctor comes in, you're going to pay for her. So if you want a refund, we can give you like a portion back. Every single person in that facility knew that I was on the fence. Not a single person asked me, are you okay? Are you sure? Do you know about your other options? Is your boyfriend coercing you? Nothing. It was just, you know, let's change her mind. Let's get her to change her mind. And they ultimately did get me to take that pill through some pretty blatant lies regarding my ultrasound. I asked to see my ultrasound. I said, I need to see my baby. And the doctor, even though it was a transvaginal ultrasound, so there's a wand inside my body and it's moving. And when that wand moves, the picture moves on the screen. But she showed me a screen that was not moving, which means she had taken a photograph of my ultrasound and turned the monitor around to show me a photograph, a still shot. And she said, oh, I'm so sorry to tell you, your baby's not viable. There's no heartbeat. It's already dead. And my boyfriend, he breathed this giant sigh of relief and landed over the top of me on my chest to chest. And he's going, oh, thank God. She released us from the guilt of killing our child. But I knew that she was lying. She was showing me a still picture. And so while my boyfriend was relieved, I wasn't. And yet I took on this responsibility of his relief. Like if I didn't go through with this, I was going to ruin him. You know, it was my responsibility to make sure that he felt safe and relieved. It was terrible.
Mm-hmm. Well, yeah, Elizabeth Gillette is with us. Incredibly important, powerful testimony here today with Elizabeth. We're going to have more when we get back. And so much to learn from what Elizabeth is sharing with us today. Just one thing to put an exclamation point on right now. And I want to say to the men, look, we've got to step up, right? This is why we do the Men's March, themensmarch.com, everything that we do there. We've got to take the lead on this. It's not just the boyfriends or the guy, coercing, pressuring, not supporting, truly supporting the mom in need. It's all of us. We've all got to take our role and get to the end of this and support every woman in this. We're going to be right back. Stay tuned.
Please join Father Mark Noonan in praying the Litany of Humility.
O Jesus, meek and humble of heart, hear me. From the desire of being esteemed, deliver me, Jesus. From the desire of being loved, deliver me, Jesus. From the desire of being extolled, deliver me, Jesus. From the desire of being honored, deliver me, Jesus. From the desire of being praised, deliver me, Jesus. From the desire of being preferred to others, deliver me, Jesus. From the desire of being consulted, deliver me, Jesus. From the desire of being approved, deliver me, Jesus. From the fear of being humiliated, deliver me, Jesus. From the fear of being despised, deliver me, Jesus. From the fear of suffering rebukes, deliver me, Jesus. From the fear of being calumniated, deliver me, Jesus. From the fear of being forgotten, deliver me, Jesus. From the fear of being ridiculed, deliver me, Jesus. From the fear of being wronged, deliver me, Jesus. From the fear of being suspected, deliver me, Jesus. That others may be loved more than I, Jesus, grant me the grace to desire it. That others may be esteemed more than I, Jesus, grant me the grace to desire it. That in the opinion of the world, others may increase and I may decrease, Jesus, grant me the grace to desire it. That others may be chosen and I set aside, Jesus, grant me the grace to desire it. That others may be praised and I unnoticed, Jesus, grant me the grace to desire it. That others may be preferred to me in everything, Jesus, grant me the grace to desire it, that others may become holier than I, provided that I may become as holy as I should. Jesus, grant me the grace to desire it. Amen.
Simple Truth, Jim Havens here. Testimony Tuesday, Elizabeth Gillette is with us, ElizabethGilletteAuthor.com. One other point that I think I have to highlight from what Elizabeth shared in that last segment is also going to the abortion center, the abortion killing center, the Planned Parenthood, and thinking, you know, so many times we've heard this when I've been active in sidewalk ministry, talking to moms from the sidewalk and hearing them say, hey, I was praying for some sort of a sign. I was praying for God to do something, to put something in my way in the midst of this. Elizabeth shared something similar. Just if there's somebody on the sidewalk there, if there's somebody who can reach out, and the fact that there was nobody there, how many times is that happening every single day at these killing centers, where people are going in and out and there's nobody there. There's no hands and feet of Christ there present for them. This is something that the church really ought to take on, and that is making sure that every outside of every killing center, that we've got at least two people every single hour that they are open as the hands and feet of Christ, including there for the workers, there for everybody reaching out in authentic love. And there, that to me is a no-brainer. It has been for many years. We've tried to build this up, and certainly did locally in Rochester, New York. But I want to just give people some resources on this. Sidewalk ministry training webinars and resources that we put together, you can go to lovewillendchildkilling.com. There's also healing resources there. So if you experienced abortion in some way, you're hurting, you don't know where to turn, a lot of helpful resources there for support, and those that that are there for you, that are they've either been through it or been trained to help you out. There's a lot of people there. There's a community that is there ready with open arms for you. We love you. You're not alone. And again, all of us need to really take and understand our responsibility, especially men, to be on the sidewalk and be those good men that we are called to be, so that, yeah, there's just nobody going in there without somebody reaching out. I'm so sad to hear that, and you're so sorry, Elizabeth. And that's the last thing I guess I need to say here, and that is I've heard people say, you know, I never say I'm sorry for what somebody else has done. But at the same time, I've reflected on this quite a bit. I do think when there's opportunities as men to say we're sorry for what other men have done on behalf of all men, it is good for us to just simply say, I'm sorry on behalf of all men. I'm sorry on behalf of that man. I think it's something that needs to be put out there, that people need to hear, that women need to hear. That these things are wrong, these evils that men have committed, and that we know that any man in that situation, if he truly wanted to support any mom in need who is pregnant and in need, and especially if that's your child, the support that she needs is not what the lie the world tells you, which is to say that, hey, whatever you want, I'm with you. That's certainly not supportive. What's supportive is to say, I'm with you. We're going to have this child. We're going to love this child. I love you. I'm going to be with you. I'm going to support you in all of this. We're going to be together in all this. That's the way you support somebody through something like that. And so we've got a long way to go. But by God's grace, each one of us, repentance, taking responsibility, facing the reality, making a new resolve to do more and to do better. And that's what we're all about. Themensmarch.com if you want to get involved with some opportunities there as well. But Elizabeth, already just so powerful what you have shared, so helpful. What else would you like to share with us?
Well, thank you for saying that. I think it's really important that men understand that abortion is not just a women's issue. Abortion is a humanity issue. And I know that a lot of people will say the opposite, you know, no uterus, no opinion. But, you know, that child is half a man's as well. So it's time that men step up and fight for that. And I think that I had seen such a good example of men standing up and fighting for justice in my family of origin that I really wasn't prepared for the world not standing up. I expected someone to help me. And I think that maybe was a flaw in my own calculations there. So I do want to share what happened with my chemical abortion, because a lot of people are saying that the chemical abortion is easy, it's as safe as Tylenol. That's not true. And it is a little graphic, so I just want to give a little bit of a warning there. I went home and, well, let me back up a second here. I was in the facility and I was refusing to take the pill. I asked, can I take it at home? Can I take it home and think about it and take it at home? And the doctor said, no, you have to take it in front of me. So I ended up waiting about 45 minutes in her office, just shredded, trying to convince myself that this was right, trying to get out of there, find some way of escape. And I ended up finally just taking the pill to get home. And the next day I took the second pill, which is the pill that starts your contractions. And it was brutal. It was severe pain. The bleeding was extreme. It was pooling around my legs. I ended up sitting on the toilet for several hours until finally I felt pressure. And I actually reached down and scooped out the complete amniotic sac with my baby floating inside of it, dead. No one prepares you for that. You're told it's going to be like a double period. You're not told, look, you're going to pass your baby. You're going to hold your dead baby in a pool of blood. You're going to look at that perfectly formed tiny human, and you're going to have no choice but to flush it down the toilet. And we're condemning women to do this in their own homes. Women now are the sole reason why their child is dead. They don't even have the step back of, yeah, a doctor did a procedure to me. No, I did that to myself. I swallowed that pill. I held that child. I flushed that child. I walk over the septic tank every day where my child's grave is, and I have to deal with that every single day. The post-traumatic stress started, the horrible dreams started very shortly after. There was no relief. They promised me I would feel relieved. I could just go on with my life. I started restricting calories. I developed anorexia, broken relationships. I immediately broke up with my boyfriend. I could not look him in the eye. I didn't hate him. I could not hate him, but I just didn't love him anymore. Someone who had done that and kind of pushed me onto that path and didn't rescue me. And it was just a really difficult downward spiral of self-hatred and loathing, and this darkness, this sickness that bloomed inside of me and really overshadowed who I truly was as a person. And I knew that Jesus was there. I even probably went to Mass. I don't remember specifically, but it was like Jesus was there, and I said, not today, and I just closed the door in his face. Even after everything, after seeing this beautiful vision, after receiving him, after just, you know, Easter Vigil Mass, when I became a full Catholic, this secret, this sin was so powerful and so shameful, I would rather die for eternity than hand it over to Christ and admit what I had done. It was safer to hide in this dark place than it was to let Christ in.
Yeah, it's just, just so sad. And I'm just so sorry. And in the midst of all that, was there anybody that you were able to talk with, able to share any of this experience with, anybody who was truly, authentically loving and supportive and helping you to kind of pick up the pieces here?
No, nope, I was completely alone in this. And I think that had I shared it with my parents or my mom, I think that they would have been that for me. But I was too afraid. And fear is, you know, it's the opposite of love. Fear truly is. It's not hate. I'm a firm believer that fear is the opposite of love, because when you fear something, you will give up love. I was afraid to have a child, and so I killed my child. I let fear steal that child away from me. I did not have the courage to fight for her or for him. So after this horrific abortion, I immediately found another man. I mean, that's what I did, right? I found another man. I got pregnant almost immediately. He ended up abandoning me, hook, line, and sinker, stealing my credit card, my debit card. I mean, it was just textbook abuse, I guess. And I ended up having this child, my daughter. She's 11 now. And I knew that there was no way I could do an abortion again. I knew it was wrong. I had to keep this child. You know, my dad suggested I should give her up for adoption, but I knew I needed her. I needed her as much as she needed me. And her birth was so beautiful. And to be able to hold her, I remember holding her alone in the middle of the night saying, I will never hurt you. I will never. She didn't know that what I was talking about was, I'm not going to murder you. I chose you. I chose to have you and to keep you and to hold you. And that was the beginning of the long climb out of this pit, to hold a life and in a way to redeem, in a sense, what I had done before, was the beginning. And I raised her with a substantial help from my parents. I went back to college. I got a master's degree in education. I started dating someone else, and lo and behold, we're pregnant again. Because apparently I had not learned the lesson. And I knew I needed to give birth to this child as well. But after I became pregnant with my son, my third crisis pregnancy, I knew I was done. I was so tired and so broken and so in need of saving and rescuing. And I realized there's nobody that can rescue me. There's no man that's going to rescue me. The only thing I have left, the only hope I have, is Jesus. And I went to confession for the first time in years. And I remember sitting in the church. It's a beautiful church here in the Salem area, St. Edward's. I want them to know that it's them, because that church was so full of Christ and so welcoming to me, who was so broken. I had my daughter. I took her with me because I didn't have any child care. I'm pregnant. And we went in to the room, and there was a partition. And I said, if I'm going to do this, I'm going to do it face to face. We're going to face this. And I went around the partition and I said, Father, I have to look you in the eye. And I confessed. I confessed everything. I couldn't even remember the act of contrition. I had probably memorized it my senior year of high school, but I think when you're face to face and you're saying, help me, I'm sorry, it doesn't matter if you recite something or if you say what comes out of your heart. And I walked out of that confessional reborn. I was a new creation, new, brand new. And I immediately told my mom about my abortion. I told her everything. I made a video that I posted on Facebook that it was explaining the situation, and it went viral. I had over 750 views in a matter of days. The backlash from that was something I didn't expect, and it was almost enough to put me back into the secret. But thankfully, I had God on my side this time.
Hmm. Wow. Yeah, Elizabeth Gillette is with us. Just amazing testimony. Praise be to God for the way that he does come to rescue us, that he has come that he is coming, that he will come to rescue us in the mess, the various messes that we find ourselves in. We're going to have a final segment with Elizabeth when we get back, but this is a reminder of why we fight for the end of abortion. We fight to build up those sidewalks outside of those abortion centers, but also to end it, to end it. We're fighting for real people. We're going to be right back. Stay tuned.
The church was born from the wounded side of the crucified Christ. Christ who came amongst us to convict the world of sin, to recall the world to that truth which is one, to the faith which saves through the church, to the love of God, to the love of God which is always first, to know, love, and serve God in this world, and to be happy with Him in the next.
That's Sermons for Everyday Living, weekdays from 6 to 7 a.m. Eastern on the Station of the Cross.
This is Nathan Wigfield, Executive Director of the St. Thomas More House of Prayer, a Catholic retreat center in Cranberry, Pennsylvania, with the mission of praying and promoting the Liturgy of the Hours. The Catholic Church teaches that when we pray the Liturgy of the Hours, we join the prayer of Christ Himself. It is the perfect sacrifice of praise that extends every Eucharistic celebration into the hours of the day to sanctify time in the whole range of human activity. To learn more, please visit us or go to liturgyofthehours.org.
Hi, I'm Debbie Giorgiani.
And I'm Adam Bly.
Join us for the Spirit World on the Station of the Cross.
Don't be laying hands on people, and definitely don't be giving commands in the name of Jesus, leave so-and-so.
So what can we say if we feel like there is demonic activity? What can we do?
The sacramental graces of baptism, confession, and the Mass remove the vast majority of demonic problems outside of possession.
The Spirit World, every Saturday at 11 a.m. right here on the Station of the Cross.
Back to the Simple Truth. Jim Havens here. Very blessed to have Elizabeth Gillette with us on this Testimony Tuesday. Elizabeth is a Catholic wife, mother, pro-life advocate, writer, speaker, author of the new book coming out in October through OSV, Above All Love, Discerning Ways to Defend Life with Charity and Justice. You can find more at elizabethgilletteauthor.com. All right, final segment to go. Elizabeth, can you comment on a little bit? There are so many women, just looking at the statistics, that that do end up experiencing abortion, sadly, in the time in which we live. Very few proportionally end up really seeming to turn with sincere repentance, getting to the confessional where they can receive our Lord Jesus and then receive a healing, a strengthening, a sense of mission with our Lord Jesus to then be speaking out and sharing testimony about their experience and trying to really be a part of this rescue mission to try to help and to rescue others before they experience this, or perhaps a message of healing afterwards, but to bring this stuff to the light because it goes so hidden. And there's so much hurt and there's so much evil taking place, and everybody's just kind of going along with life like, you know, nothing's going on. We've got an ongoing daily mass murder of 3,000 babies every day. That's 3,000 pregnant moms in need experiencing this hurt, having their hearts turned away from their children and being devastated in this way. So many fathers as well, siblings, it ripples out into the culture. There's no bigger issue in our time than this. Can you help us explain or help us to understand your experience of how you knew that you were called to go forward and share testimony?
Yeah. So I have to give you a quick story here. My grandfather, he was not a Christian until the end of his life, and we always wondered, like, did he make it to heaven? I chuckle because, like, he was a wonderful man. He lived his life honestly. He was just really a wonderful man. And at his deathbed, you know, in the hospital, a neighbor had counseled him about Christ. And we always wondered, was that enough? After my abortion, I had made this video. I had received so many just awful, hateful messages. I had to take the video down because I wasn't strong enough in my truth and in the truth, that I yielded. And the video came down. And I remember praying, Lord, would you please tell me what you want me to do with this? Like, I know you don't remember the sin because it's been cast away from me, but I do, and I'm still walking in this mire, and I just need to know what to do. And also, by the way, was it a boy or a girl? So I, that night, had a beautiful dream. I was walking through a marble cavernous building that I innately knew was peaceful and full of love, and I could feel, I could sense Christ everywhere. I knew that there were people in all of these different rooms, but they weren't meant for me. And I just kept following this path until I came into this beautiful room. And in the room was a couch. And on the couch was my grandfather holding my son. I knew he's there. He has my baby. He's going to watch him for me. And it's a boy. And I know that, you know, maybe dreams seem a little far-fetched, but for me, that's how God told me. And we have women in our church. We have women in our parishes, a lot of women that are holding this secret. And if you went to every single woman in your parish, they would say no, because the shame of coming out, the shame of saying, yeah, I did this, the ability to say, the church is correct on this, the church has these teachings and they're correct, is a lot. It's more than most people want to swallow, because you have to admit to your choice. You have to admit that what you've done is incorrect. You have to admit that you are a sinner and you need healing. And that is extremely difficult to do. But what we forget is that once you do that, once you give that up, Jesus will equip you with absolutely everything that you need to take the next step and then the next step until you're able to say yes every single time. And we're not allowing ourselves the opportunity for Jesus to equip us. We're saying no to those gifts. We are saying, no, Jesus, I got this. I can figure this one out on my own. I don't really believe that 2,000 years of doctrine is actually relevant today. Or I don't really believe that it's killing because it's just a blob of cells. Or, you know, I did what was best for my family and I did what was best for my other three children. Or we don't have finance. I mean, the reasons are infinite, right? But in doing that and in refusing to admit that, and in refusing to face that guilt, women are allowing themselves to float out in the middle of the sea without any direction. I don't know how else to explain this, except if you have had an abortion and you are not facing the reality of what that was and what that did to your baby and what that did to your soul and yourself, you have got to have Jesus with you to continue moving forward. If you don't give that to him, he cannot help you. If you do not give him your sin and let him take care of it for you and let him die on the cross with that sin for you, you are going to flounder. There's no way you can reach your potential. There's no way you can say yes to Jesus in these other areas of your life. You don't get to have part of it and not all of it. You have to surrender. When you go to confession, you surrender everything. You don't hold back. You don't surrender, oh, I called my husband a bad name, but I'm not going to tell you about my abortion. That's an incomplete confession. And that's happening. That's happening all over the place in our church. And I'm not here to judge, because guess what? I did that too for years. But it wasn't until I gave up the sin that the devil had his foothold on. It wasn't until then that I started to see the fruits of Jesus Christ in my life. And let me tell you, they are unexpected and they are incredible. And there are more than I ever could have imagined, these fruits.
Yeah. Elizabeth, thank you so much for sharing your testimony as you do, and for helping all of us to better face reality. I do pray that some of the fruits for us will be to all better repent of what we've done, what we haven't done as well, and to take responsibility, make a new resolve to do more, to do better. Can't wait to check out your book as it comes out in October. Anything else you want to share with us today in just the last couple minutes here, feel free.
Yeah, I would like to offer a technique that I use. It's some people find it really difficult to forgive. And in this world, this culture of death, we have so much to forgive. And one each other, you know, maybe your daughter had an abortion or something. I don't know. But what I do is I imagine the person who has harmed me, I imagine that person as an infant. The moment they come into this world, they are perfect. They are innocent. And that is who Jesus sees. And if we can see that dignity and that humanity in every person, forgiveness will flow freely.
Yeah. So beautiful. Yeah, Elizabeth Gillette. Again, you can get more information. You can find her book as it comes out in October, ElizabethGilletteAuthor.com. But that is so true. You know, we were all that size once. We were all little babies once. And we were all, it's very easy to see how lovable a little baby is. If we can look at each other as we're walking around and think of each other in that way, very, very helpful. God bless you all.